said about money on empty, once you put it down, you will not be able to pick it up. I can't think of anyone who would be more appropriate to receive this award than David Cote. He has truly answered the call for statesmanship by addressing our debt crisis. As some of you may know, Charlie Lindfield had been passionate about this issue for nearly three decades. I didn't realize how relentlessly boring until Winston Lord, the former ambassador to China, introduced me recently. He said he'd been down to Guantanamo, and he was interviewing the prisoners down there. And he discovered that threatening him with a talk by Pete Peterson on long-term debt was far more effective than waterboarding. So I'm not going to go on with anything about my view. Dave is currently the chairman and CEO of Honeywell. He's had a distinguished career for many years at GE, and I think it's no surprise that his colleagues Jeff Himmel and Jim McNerney, both GE alums, have received the award. And Jeff, of course, was the inaugural recipient. Last year, Dave Cote was appointed by President Barack Obama to the National Commission on Fiscal Responsibility, chaired by Alan Simpson and Erskine Bowen. He was one of two business leaders who worked on that commission to advocate a robust and credible long-term deficit reduction plan. Tom Friedman may call many of us in business as MIAs, that is, missing on action on key issues in this issue. Dave Cote has been in the forefront for years. He is out there on talk shows, engaging other CEOs, talking to policymakers and public officials, because he believed and believes that real fiscal reform can be achieved, and he has not given up. David, your leadership is truly exceptional. It shows in the way you have installed a culture of growth, of innovation, and corporate responsibility at Honeywell. You and your colleagues have created the Honeywell Hometown Solutions, focusing on where the company can use its unique expertise to strengthen your communities, their people, and their families. Your commitment to community leadership and responsibility, coupled with your remarkable dedication, serving this nation is truly outstanding. Dave, we salute you and your deep commitment to being a true business statesman. Dave, please join me at the Honeywell Hotline.
Thanks to you, Peter, and the rest of the Business Statesmanship Awards Committee, as well as the CED's Board of Trustees, for this very prestigious award. I have to say, it really does feel terrific. Thank you. Now, when Pete reached out to me to ask to accept the award that carries his name, I have to admit I was more than a little flattered, because Pete's spectacular success in virtually every area, from the business world, to public service, to philanthropy, has served as an inspiration for us all. His passionate commitment to doing what it takes to ensure America's future prosperity has helped spark and expand our ongoing national debate on the importance of getting our fiscal house in order. I'm truly flattered and humbled that Amanda has inspired so many who would cite me for this terrific honor, so thank you. I'd also like to congratulate all of tonight's honorees, Case Kreitoff and Unilever, Beth Brooke and Ernst & Young, another good friend, Andrew Liveris of the Dow Chemical Company, Landon H. Rowland of Everglades Financial, and Edward Kangas of Deloitte too. So please join me in a round of applause for them. I also think it's important to acknowledge the economic summit that we had this morning. Speakers and the attendees did a great job, and I offer my thanks to all of them for adding energy to the very important policy issues that are facing our country, especially debt reduction, which we all know has to be addressed. As I said this morning, we need to recognize that we are in a dramatically different global economy than we were just 20 years ago. 20 years ago, there were only about a billion people involved in the global economy. Today, there are about 4 billion active participants in the global economy, with the addition of China, India, former CIS states, Russia, and others who are interested in achieving the same kind of prosperity that the US and Europe have because of the focus on the private sector. Now, this new economy will move forward with us or without us. And now is the time for us to be pulling together, not pulling apart. I'm dismayed that our elected representatives seem unable to break free of their discordant pluralism and to work together to create an American competitiveness agenda. But I would like to see focus on 6 areas. I know Andrew would agree with these 6 areas as they're further developed in his book. The first is debt reduction. We are on the path to be spending $1 trillion annually in interest in 10 years. I'd like to put that number in perspective, because all of us are familiar with millions, with billions, and the trillion just seems like the next number in line. But if you had spent $1 million a day since Jesus Christ was born, 2011 or so years ago, you would still not have spent $1 trillion. And that will be our annual interest bill. This just can't continue. The second area is energy policy. Now, some ask whether to focus on energy generation or energy efficiency. And the key, of course, is to do both. We've estimated that just aggressively using existing Honeywell products could save the U.S. 20 to 25% of our annual energy bill. So imagine what we could do as a country if we just deploy all the tools with all the company's products that are available today. There is a huge opportunity for efficiency, but it requires a change to our system of incentives and behaviors. And in the meantime, we do need more oil, gas, and renewable energy. The third area is math and science education. Engineers, scientists, and technologists are the drivers of innovation and productivity. And more productivity means a better standard of living and a more prosperous society. We need that Sputnik moment that galvanizes kids to want to be engineers. The fourth area is infrastructure development. While we do need to cut spending, we also need to spend intelligently on those things government can do to enable business. And investing in infrastructure is one area where that makes a lot of sense. The fifth area is free trade, including developing a more thoughtful, nuanced, comprehensive relationship with China. When I'm asked if China is a partner, a competitor, a customer, or a supplier, my answer is always yes. It's all of those. That's the way we need to think about it. And finally, tort reform. It's a sad commentary when other countries think twice about investing in the U.S. for fear of lawsuits. Addressing these 6 areas would give America the leverage we need to create a fair, dynamic, and economic environment where innovation, cooperation, and prosperity can flourish. But we have to act. We can't wait for the next economic crisis to happen, because then it will be too late. This is one of the things that scares me both as a businessman and as a citizen, because we can see what's coming and we can see what we're not doing about it. I believe that we can effect meaningful changes in our country if we work together, make the tough decisions, and take the right steps to confront these difficult issues. And I would ask that all of you here join me in working toward that goal and encourage your elected representatives in Washington to stop arguing, think about compromise, and actually start to get something done. Again, my most sincere thanks to the honor you've given me this